I was kind of liking that one. I kind of like that. Dun, 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 dun. Come on in. Come on into worship. Come on. Dun, dun. Welcome, welcome. Dun, dun. Yeah, I was kind of feeling that. I was like, we love you, Jesus. Yeah, can you sing that? Oh, Jesus. That's where it was. Jesus. Dun, dun. We love you, Jesus. Yeah, come on. Jesus. Yeah. We love you, Jesus. Come on in. Come on in. Oh, Jesus. Yeah, yeah, yeah. We love you, Jesus. Make the service all about him. Come on, just say, Jesus. Yeah, yeah. We love you, Jesus. Come on, I can't sing either. Just sing it. Jesus. Make it about him. We love you, Jesus. Last time. Come on. Say, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Now we go down on the last one. Jesus. Here we go. We love you, Jesus. Come on, give the Lord a hand of praise. Isn't he worthy this morning? Come on, come on, come on. Welcome into the house of service. Welcome to Breath for Change Church. Welcome, family and friends. I am PC. Welcome to Sunday worship with Pastor Cherry. It is my pleasure and my delight to lead you in worship today. Shauna, Joy, Jana is in the house supporting, helping, hosting to make sure you get everything you need. This is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Are you ready to worship him? I'm ready to worship him. Before we worship, I've got a scripture I want to share with you out of Psalm 100. We're going to read the scripture out of Psalm 100, and it says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands, serve the Lord with gladness, come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good. His mercy is everlasting, and his truth endures to all generations. This is what Sunday worship is all about. Making a joyful noise unto the Lord, making him the center of the focus of all that we do. That's when you have church, when God is at the center of why you come to church. It can't be about the preacher. It can't be about the choir. It can't be about the deacons. It can't be about fine hoo-hoo over there or muscular so-and-so over there. It's got to be about God. And when God is the focus of our worship, that's when things happen. For the Bible says he inhabits the praises of his people. And that's what we want God to do. We want him to come. We want him to sit down and reside in our midst, because that's when the joy of the Lord comes. His presence, in his presence, the Bible says, is the fullness of joy. I don't want to just be here online. I don't want to be wasting time. I want to lift my praise to God. I want to make connection with heaven so that his presence come and I walk away from this service changed. Can I get an amen? Can I get an amen from somebody out there? Write it in the comments. I want to see it in the comments. Come on, aren't you ready to worship the Lord? Let's have a word of prayer, and then we'll have some worship, and I'll come back and we'll talk some more, and then we'll give you the word. Let's pray. Father, thank you for today's worship. We bless you for all that you've done. We bless you for all who you are. We pray to God that you would receive our praise, receive our glory, forgive our sins, cover us with your blood, fill us with your spirit, meet us in this place, speak to our hearts, God. Charge us and challenge us and motivate us to leave this place inspired to serve you, to reach another soul, to show love in the world so we can make a difference for your kingdom. Bless us now, O God, we pray in the mighty and powerful name of Jesus. Amen. You believe in that prayer? Say amen. Let's worship together. Sing it from your heart as we worship the Lord. Amen. Come on and lift your hearts before the Lord this morning as we worship him and give him thanks for his healing, for the change he has placed in our lives, made possible by the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. If you've been changed and you've been delivered, sing this song with me this morning. Say, I've been changed.
I've been changed.
And delivered. I found joy. Oh God. Peace. Grace. Oh yes. And favor. Come on, say it again. I've been changed. Hallelujah. I've been healed. In your presence, Lord, I've been free. And delivered. I found joy. Oh God, great peace. Your grace and your amazing favor. Come on.
Right now is the moment.
Today is the day.
Today is the day.
I've been changed.
I have waited
for this moment to come,
and I will not let it pass me by.
Come on, sing this part. Say, I won't go back.
I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be.
Before your presence
came and changed me.
Say, I won't go back.
Came and changed me.
All my shame. All my guilt, God. All of my sins. They've been forgiven.
Today is the day.
I've been changed. Come on, somebody say it. I have waited
for this moment to come.
And I won't let it pass me by. And say, I won't go back. I can't go back.
No. For your presence came to change me.
Say, I won't go back.
I won't go back.
I can't go back.
No.
Hallelujah.
For your presence came to change me.
Hey.
I won't go back.
Can't go back
to to the way it used to be.
Hallelujah.
For your presence came and changed me.
Oh, come on, say I won't go back. Said I won't go back.
I won't go back.
Can't go back
to the way it used to be.
Hey.
For your presence came and changed me.
Come on, shout hallelujah. I won't go back. I can't go back. Can't go back to the way I used to be before your presence changed me. Hallelujah. How many of you are determined? You've decided I can't go back to that old way. And the reality is that old lifestyle ain't nothing to it. First of all, you can't even keep up with that madness anymore. And you realize it has worn you out. When I had knee surgery, back years ago, the doc was like, he said you just overworked your knees playing sports, you know, football, baseball, softball, basketball, day after day, week after week, year after year, it'll wear you out. And that old lifestyle, it'll wear you out. But then when we get saved, God tries to give us a lifestyle of moderation. He tries to bring us to a place where we grow and we learn how to live in moderation, where we don't overwork ourselves. We learn to work and walk by faith, to trust God more, to not be so anxious and overstressed. We live with a God who we know is going to protect us, cover us, and take care of our needs. We shouldn't be tripping and stressed out and fighting people and running after people and all this kind of stuff. Look, I'm telling all my old lifestyle, right? y'all never did any of that stuff. Well, thank you for joining in worship this morning. It's offering time. It's time for you to be able to give an offering. We're going to put the offering on the screen, the address. You can go to the website and give your offering at pastorcherry.org/donate. Let's put the address on the screen. You can give through there. I want to pray for you right before we move on to the next segment. Father, I pray for every giver and every gift. I ask your blessings on their offering. I pray to God that you would use their gifts for the expansion of your kingdom. And as always, I pray that you would reciprocate, that you would meet their needs, provide for their rent, their car notes, their clothes, food, whatever it is they need, God, even some wants and desires that they have in their life. I ask that you bless them real good so that we can continue to serve you and just live in the cycle of provision. We thank you for it all in Jesus' name. Thank you. I want to talk about God's grip from this standpoint, that the difference between a change in your life can be as simple as the change in your grip.
Okay.
Okay? So when you talk about change, you talk about sometimes things don't change because of a refusal to let go of a particular grip. And so we must learn the difference between our grip and God's grip. Tracking?
Yeah.
So today I want to give you a difference between something came to my mind this week prior to study, and you've heard this term, a death grip, right? You've heard the death grip, and I thought to myself, wow, well, there's a death grip, but is there a life grip? And so I began to look a little further, and well, if there's a death grip, is there a life grip? But then I had some problems with the life grip. And then even the life grip may not have been the best grip. And then God said, well, go a little deeper. And then we got all the way to God's grip, which trumps, well, we'll talk about it in a second. In this particular text, we're going to be in Isaiah. Isaiah 49, verses 13 through 16. Isaiah 49, 13 through 16. And in this particular setting, God was allowing his people to come back to the promised land after being in captivity. So there's a change occurring. He was telling them to come back and celebrate. I've ended your captivity and you're good now. So celebrate, right? But they had been in captivity for so long that they were reluctant and hesitant to be happy because the promises God made to them were deferred. It took a long time. And they didn't trust that God was going to do it. So, in other words, they couldn't make the change from slavery to freedom because they couldn't let go of what they had been in for so long. Track it? So it forces us to kind of analyze where our grip is. And if the thing holding us up from maximizing who we are could be as simple as changing our grip.
All right.
Okay, well, let's see. So the text says in Isaiah 49, I'm just going to read the text. This is God telling his people, sing, O heavens, and what? Be joyful, O earth, and break forth into singing, O mountains. For the Lord has comforted his people and will have mercy upon his afflicted. Now notice, too, he's telling the heavens to sing. He's telling the earth to have joy and to break forth in singing, and he's saying for the mountains to have a shout. Yes. Why? Because the people have been comforted. So he's telling even the earth to change its demeanor and disposition because of what God has done for us.
Right.
The Bible says in one area as well, if we fail to shout, the rocks will cry out. So this text seems to advocate to some degree, I'm not supposed to spend time here, but that the earth has the ability to praise. It has the ability to make God feel good if we don't. All right? So if you can't change your life and if you can't get it together, God will resort to looking at his creation for the type of extolling that he desires for that day. Let's go further. But Zion said, this is the people, the Lord hath forsaken me, and my Lord hath forgotten me. So they feel in some kind of way. The Lord has said, I've comforted you, but surely he's forsaken us. He's forgotten all about me. Well, okay. So his response is, can a woman forget her sucking child that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Yeah, they may forget, meaning the mother of the child, yet will I not forget? So their response was, surely he's forgotten us. We over here in this wilderness. We over here in slavery, and he has forgotten us. Ain't no way we can get a shot in. He says, well, a mother who has a child nursing may forget, but I won't. Right. Don't put me in the boat.
Amen.
Isn't it true? If our friends let us down, time after time after time after time after time, we have a tendency to say, well,
that's right.
Amen.
Well, God let us. No. Jeffrey let you down. Sheila, Tammy, Bob, Trey, they let you down, but God didn't.
Amen. That's right.
So don't put God in the category of your
friends. Yes, sir.
Okay. And family. So he says, behold, I have graven you. God, I felt him in my spirit there. I have graven you upon the palms of my. Thy walls are continually before me. I have graven you on the palms of my. What's the title of the sermon? God's
grip.
I have put you in the palms of my hand. Let's talk about number one, the death grip. Oh, you see that one now, right? This is the grip of the hand. Can you do that? Can you kind of grip your hand together? Just as if you're going to hold it. Squeeze it real tight, like you're going to hold it tight. You're going to, you know, you go to the doctor, they say, squeeze it tight, as tight as you can. All right, you can let go now. I don't want you to break out and break your fingers. This is the grip. I want you to imagine a death grip. A death grip now is a strong grip. It is applied from, listen, a death grip is applied from the position of fear. A death grip comes from the position of fear. It is likened to a drowner. You've heard the story about someone who drowns and they're drowning and someone jumps in to get them.
Yes.
It is said that that person enacts a death grip on the person who's trying to save them.
Yes, sir.
And their death grip, watch this, causes them both to die.
That's right.
Watch this. So the grip you have on something could be the reason you're dying. And your failure to make a change is because you fail to let go of what you're holding on to. But remember, your grip is a grip of fear. And we are afraid that if we let go of this, and what the lifeguard will say, just relax, calm down, I got you. In other words, don't let go, don't hold on to me. Let me hold on to you. I'm here now. What I'm trying to get you to understand is the difficulty or the difference of gripping something to the point where you lock and you don't get the change you need because technically you're dead spiritually. And whatever you had a hold of, it gets locked in your hand.
Right.
So true.
Don't raise your hand, but who's locked to their vicious past?
Yes.
You have a death grip on it, and you will not let it go. This is a grip out of fear, and it is in response to some emotion. Remember I told you the difference between making mental, logical, thoughtful actions instead of emotional actions? A lot of our emotional actions are emotional grips. They are fears or grips that are made out of fear, and it has locked us in. So let's look at the text. Watch this. He says, sing, O heavens, and be joyful, O earth, and break forth into singing, O mountains, for the Lord hath comforted his people, and will have mercy upon his afflicted. Then he says, but Zion said, the Lord hath forsaken me, and my Lord hath forgotten me. So two aspects. We've got forsaken and forgotten. They feel forsaken and they feel forgotten. But the first verse actually said, sing, be joyful, for the Lord has comforted you. But you can't sing and be joyful because you feel forsaken and you feel forgotten. Get the text. So a lot of times we can't rejoice and we can't, oh man, you have no reason really to not be happy. Really, if you look at whatever day that is, you have no reason to, but you're frowning and you're used to being sad, disappointed, let down, that you can't rejoice because you feel forsaken and forgotten, where you may have been forsaken and forgotten, but that was last week. The Bible says, give us this day our daily bread. Most of us live with a baggage full of last year and last week. Separate yourself from what has happened back then and put yourself in a position to rejoice in what's happening today. As of today, are you forsaken? As of today, are you forgotten? God didn't say go back to last year and rejoice and sing. He said today. Can you find joy today? Did he break up with you today? Did you get fired today? Did you get robbed today? That was last week and you survived. God has you still here. Then rejoice in the Lord always. And again I say, rejoice. Can you find a way to release the grip on your past? We lose our song when we feel forgotten. We lose our song when we feel forsaken. And when you feel forsaken and when you feel forgotten and when you have no song, guess what you are, Tia? You are weak. For the Bible says, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Oh God. So when I have joy in my heart, that's when God says I'm strong. And the enemy chooses to try to keep you haunted by your past and keep your grip so strong on what is ailing you and what you cannot change anyway. You can't even go back and undo it, yet you hold on to it as if it's sacred, as if it's a monument or an idol of a memorial that you must stay committed to. Foolishness. You are losing your strength, and every day you walk in being forsaken, or excuse me, feeling forsaken, is every day you walk in weakness. And when you are in weakness, the enemy can trample over you. You need a song to be able to be strong. Yeah, I like that. You need a song to be able to be strong. Woke up this morning. morning with my mind. Stayed on Jesus. Singing and praying with my mind. Stayed on Jesus. Walking and talking with my mind. Because the old saints understood that if I can get a song out of my heart, that's when I could be strong. I couldn't understand why my mother would cook and she would sing at the same time, because she understood. I knew she was tired from working, she was tired from the stuff she was dealing with, but a song could always come up while she was stirring the potato salad or making the meatloaf. The song gave her strength when she was weak physically. Ah, song will get you up out of bed when you don't feel like going to work. A song will help you deal with a mate that you cannot stand at that particular moment. 9 times out of 10, we're upset with what a mate did last week or last today. Today, as God said to Joshua, told the people, choose ye this day whom you will serve. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Find your strength in a song and release your death grip. We and the creation should rejoice because God has promised us a refuge. I want you to understand, write this down or make sure you're clear on it, that the death grip is motivated by fear. And the more you walk around fearful of anything, you have a tendency to grip something you shouldn't be holding on to. Oh God, I feel that scripture. That if you have fear in your heart, I guarantee you, you're going to grab a hold of something that you probably shouldn't. Ah, oh, come on, give an example. Let's say you're walking down the stairs, and let's say you fear of falling, but you see the bar has thorns on it, but out of your mind, that's the only thing that's going to hold you up. So I'd rather grab the bar with the thorn on it for fear of falling rather than falling and letting God catch me. I'll have thorns all together. That's all right. If you have fear in your heart, you have a tendency to grab something that you shouldn't be grabbing. You can't rejoice when you have fear. If you're living with God, thank you, Jesus, for freedom. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you for freedom from fear. There's some stuff I used to be scared of. There's some people I used to be scared of. I ain't scared of them no more. And I'm free from fear, and now I can rejoice. That's why when I come to church, and oh, don't mess around. If the right side, I get happy in a minute. It doesn't matter. You can always get joyful when you don't have fear, because you don't have a grip on nothing that you shouldn't have a grip on. My hands are free. Some of y'all can't lift your, I won't personalize it. Some people can't lift their hands to praise him because they can't let go of what they're dealing with. I don't feel like I can't lift your hands in the sanctuary and give God some praise. No, 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 no. Dasha didn't sit me in the right seat. No, no, I'm tired. I didn't do church too early. No, no, I'm holding on. No, my husband made me mad this morning. No, I'm still single. I'm mad at God. No, you can't get free enough to. You gotta let go in order to praise him. You gotta let go. To worship and bless his name. We will never win trying to hold on.
That's right. Woo. That's right.
You will never win. That's right. Trying to hold on. Why? Because you aren't strong enough. I was watching an American Ninja or whatever it was, and they were trying to go through the obstacle course. And they had to have a grip. And one guy was almost to the end, and he dropped off because he couldn't keep his grip. He said, my arms began to burn. I just wonder, is anybody's spiritual arms burning? Where you can't hold on That's all right.
Amen.
It's all right. I'll be honest with myself. Let's talk about the life grip. Let me try to work through this one a little faster. The death grip is a grip out of fear of the past. It is our grip on the past. This grip, the life grip, is a grip to live up to your future. Some of us can't let go of the stupidity of our choices in the past. There's some folk, though, who will hold on to, trying to keep up with the Joneses and doing stupid stuff to try to make more money than they think they need. In other words, they're working three jobs and neglecting time with their family. Means that's a grip on the future. Meaning everything you do is for your future down the road. And you got a grip. Okay, now that might be the saint who has made some progress. That's the saint who has, they heard me preaching. They came to the altar and they, okay, PC, I'll let it go. And they started feeling good and said, oh, I'm on my way now. Things are finally starting to work. And they took it to think that they actually are the ones making it happen. And they feel like if I work harder, then God will bless me better. Oh, you got it. You still got the grip. You got it wrong. It is not that if I get more degrees or even some spiritualized, if I pray more, if I go to church more, if I join the choir, this will help my future. Dummy, you got a life grip. And the same result is death. This grip is a grip to live up to your future. It is life's grip on us. See, for the past, it is your grip on life. In the future, it is life's grip on you. That the Joneses keep calling you. Come on, come on, buy this car. You know you can't afford it. Come on, buy this suit, buy this dress. You know you're gonna put it on the charge card. You just paid off. You just made it. Now you, because you want to step in and look a certain, pride. Amen. Life's got a hold on you. And you do everything that you see. You do it everything everybody tells you to do. And now, okay, you let go of Sheila, but now the money's got a hold of you. And status. Okay, let's you don't believe me. Okay. Can a woman forget her sucking child, her nursing child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? Look at this. Yes, she can forget. That a woman can actually forget to have compassion on the child that's nursing from her breast. God says, I won't forget. One of the strongest grips in life, though, probably if not the most strongest, is a mother's love and her grip on a child. Amen. When she's nursing the infant. Come on now, if I got a few mamas in here who know what it's like, and even let alone nursing from the breast, just holding them, you got a bottle in their mouth. It is a connect. I want you to, I got to build this, Anna. It's a connection that the mother has maternally to the child. And it's almost as if the devil walks up and dares her to let that child go. You must be out of your mind. I will knock you out, right? The mother will fight for her. God. And you'll do anything for your child. You might let your friend be stranded, but let your child call. Mother who knows the cry of their child versus another child. You in the kitchen, but they in the back room, and you hear that cry. Whoop! Now you drop the spoon in 2 seconds. God is saying, can a mother, come on, I'm trying to get you to see the intensity with which a mother has for an infant. God says, even with all of that love and power, they still can forget you. But not in my case. On top of all that kind of love and intensity, don't get it twisted. twisted. Your mama may have forgot you. Your daddy may have forgot you. She may have walked out on you, but I never will. So don't you choose not to praise me because your daddy left you or your mama didn't want you. You gotta give me the praise because I'm not your mama and I'm not your daddy. I am your God. The Bible says if my mother and my father forsake me, then the Lord will lift me up. Read it in the Psalms. That's what it says. How can a mother forget a child that's nursing at the breast? How would she not have the ability to have compassion on that child? He says, though they have forgotten, God never will. Does anybody have any of these types of old pictures? Any parents, when you have the little baby feet and when you put the baby's hand inside your hand? I had a little picture, a friend of mine gave me a picture we took years ago. I had a little baby picture of little Cherry. He was there, he had the baseball glove on, my softball glove. It was almost big as him. And he was this wee high, and Tiana was in it, and little Gerald was in it. Wheat was still cooking. She was in the oven. But I looked at the picture, and all this love for the little one, you know. I got the big one now, but the little one, there's one picture I got where he's looking me right in the eye. He's got his finger on my lip, and he's looking at me like I'm the king of the earth, and he wants to be me. Yes. He wants to feel, it's this, you know, you feel this as a parent, and God says, just as the baby's hand is in the parent's hand who can forget you, he says, you are in. I got baby pictures. God has baby pictures of you. He says, forgiveness is, your mama may forget you, but I never will. So life's grip is the grip of a nursing child, and his grip is stronger than that. I liken this to the child as this nursing grip. The child knows, watch this, remember I told you that you're fighting for life over here, right? A child knows that when they get on the breast, they know that it's feeding time, right? And they understand that when you feed on the breast, you're going to get life. Watch this. And sometimes a mother who, you know, time is up, little Cherry. Time is up, little Johnny. Get off the nipple. But to the child, they have a life grip, right? In other words, they understand this is good. This is good for me, right? And so sometimes we're sucking at the nip and we think something is good for us because it has temporarily given us something that we gotta fit. Oh, Mari, if you could hear me preaching, don't fall asleep just for a minute. But if we put our mouths on stuff, because if a baby, if he eat first at 2 o'clock, around 6 or 8 or 9, guess what? We got to eat again, right? So whatever it is you thought was good for you, at best it is temporary. And so a life's grip we have on stuff that will never satisfy us. When Jesus told the woman at the well, he said, if you knew who I was, you would have been asking me for water. He satisfies our soul. He gives us what we need. Amen. You cannot mistake life's grip for God's grip. Our discouragement sets in when we think God is like our mother. Yeah, that's when you get discouraged. When you think God is like your father. When you think God is like your boss. When you think God is like your life's circumstances. God says, I'm none of those. People will mistreat you. People will say they love you and they don't. He says, that's not what you're going to get when you deal with me. But God knows this. He knows you need milk to live. He knows that. He knows that. But even Matthew says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and its righteousness. In other words, get your grip with God first, and all these things shall be. And you're going to get the milk. You're going to get the clothes. You're going to get the house. The Lord knows you have need of all those things. But you got the grip in the wrong place. You got the death grip out of fear of the past. You got your life grip out of commitment to your future. But you need God's grip.
Amen.
God understands that you don't have the strength to hold on to Him. God is not asking you to be so good that you can't let go. God is telling you, you ain't good enough, so let go.
Amen.
Let me get you. We spend all of our time trying to hold on to God. If I could just live right, if I could just keep these commandments, if I could just love Him more, if I could just be a better worker, that's you trying to hold it.
That's right.
That's you. If I could just make more money, I could save this house. That's you trying to hold it. The Bible says, he who loses his life, it shall be saved.
Amen.
When you let it go, that's when you get the help you need. A lot of the fights we have are because we're trying to hold on to it. Stop fighting. The Lord said, let me fight the battle for you. If they're going to walk, the Bible said, they were never with you in the first place. So let them go. Stop trying to hold on and make people stay when it is not even God's destiny for them to be with you.
Amen.
Crying and snotting, praying prayers that God don't want to answer because he's trying to get them out of your life and you're trying to keep them in the life. That's what you call conflict of interest, Shana. Both the life grip, I want you to understand this, young Ben, both the death grip and the life grip are circumstantial. This grip depends on something. This grip depends on something. But God's grip is permanent. It is not circumstantial. God is not going to let you go when you mess up. God is not going to let go when you don't get the job. God will hold you. And that's why the devil's mad. Because there ain't nothing you can do with my child. God said, ain't nothing you can do. Even the devil went up to him talking about Job. And they were like, let me get at Job. Let me get at Job then. God said, get at him. Surely he will forsake you if you let me just hit him a little bit. And he hit him hard. And Job stayed faithful. And God gave him double what he lost. What if Job would have fought to hold on to his wife who was cursing him? What if Job would have fought to hold on to the children he lost? What if Job would have had a grip on this livestock and wouldn't let him go? He never would have seen the outcome of Job. He let it go. If God took it, let it go. Does that take away the memory I have? No, it doesn't. I have to let it go knowing what it was.
Amen.
I have to let it go knowing that I have relationship with that.
Amen.
I have to let it go knowing I have a valid investment. I have to let it go knowing that I am forever connected to it.
Amen.
I'm connected by blood or by line or by actions. But I am not connected by grip.
Amen.
Amen.
So look at this as I wrap this up. God says to all of us, Calvin, he says, behold, I have graven thee upon the palms of my hands. Thy laws are continually before me. Now watch this. Because his grip is so strong on us, our body prints, our life has been engraved upon his hands.
Right.
Have you ever gripped something so tight? We used to have on the dirt bikes, you know, the grips that had the lines on it. And if you grip it and ride it for so long, when you take your hands off, on your hands are the lines from the grip on the... God says, I got you so tight. Woo! That when I let you go, the imprint, God, of who you are, woo! Still... in the palm of my hand, and no matter how far you go away from me, I will forever see the formation of your life in the palm of my hand. It was an Old Testament scenario where in the Old Testament they would draw the city in their hand, and it's like we used to do it. It's an old, it's the wrong way. It's an old way of a tattoo. People used to take a hot pen and dig into their skin, and they would engrave it until it bleeds, right? Let's take a henna tattoo. You know what a henna tattoo is?
Yeah.
Right, but the henna tattoo is painted above the skin, right?
Yeah.
But here's what it used to be in the Old Testament. They would cut into the skin first, then drop the henna design into it with glitter or something like and fancy, so that, watch this, listen, what's wrong with a henna tattoo above the skin? When you take a shower, it comes off. So God says, what I did for you is I cut into myself and I put glitter on it so that you will shine. Watch this. So not that it's a henna tattoo, but it's permanent. Now where did he cut into himself? They hung him high. They stretched him wide. They pierced his side. So that's where they began to cut in my framework. Oh, God. On the cross, my diagram was being sketched into the palm of his hand, and his blood became my blood. My blood became his blood. And so when he came off the cross, there was my life in the palm of his hand. I am forever engraven in the hand.
Amen.
Of God. He said, your walls are always before me. Remember, I told you I got the picture of the little one, right? And you try to remember those, right? But they old now, they're grown. Ain't no baby supposed to be still be sucking on the nip till they, while they 15. But the concept is, even after you're grown and gone, I will never forsake you or forget you, even though you left the physical breast. I will. And where did he get it? Where did he get the impression? He got the impression from the grip of you as an infant. He got the impression holding you while you were getting the grip. He says, I've punctured my hands, and I've punctured my feet, and I've died so you can live.
Amen.
And you got the nerve to come to church and try to hold on to life as if you can actually save yourself.
Amen.
You got it twisted.
Yes.
So true.
None of us could handle what he endured on the cross.
Amen.
None of us could.
So true.
And yet you try to play like you're God of your own life.
All right.
If it's going to be, it's up to me. Wrong.
That's right.
So true.
It's a favorable quote, and I get it in a circumstance. I get it. But the truth of it is, if it's going to be, it's up to God.
That's right.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
God,
thank you.
Because we're his tattoo.
Yes. Yes.
That's right.
All kind of folk who got a tattoo with Tyrone's name on their back when they were 15. Now they married to Jeffrey. and they're 32 and they trying to scrub that tattoo off. They trying to get that. We got some of that old soap. You got to come on, get some of that. There ain't enough. What that? Exfoliation. Exfoliate. There ain't that much exfoliating you can do in the world to get that tattoo off of you, baby. God can't forget you because I'm a permanent tat.
Amen.
All he has to do to remember me is bam.
All right.
There go a little cherry. There he is. I will never forget you. Love imprints. Fear forgets.
Yes. All right.
Love imprints. Fear forgets. God's grip is greater than a mother who's nursing her child. Every time he looks at his hand, he says, I remember you.
Amen.
So rejoice, Kel.
Amen.
You're not forsaken. You're not forgotten. Well, I messed up. I didn't ask you about your mess up. You keep bringing up yesterday.
All right.
I wrote this song, it's called Yesterday, and he said, you keep talking about yesterday. You keep bringing that up, Cherry. I'm off yesterday.
Right.
I'm trying to enjoy you right now.
That's right.
So, watch this. Write these two texts down, because this seals the deal, and I'm done. He says, John 10:28, and I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out. Woo! Somebody better run. Woo! My feet about to bust. I don't even know if that feet makes any sense. But God says, nobody.
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 You are tatted in my hand.
All right.
And there's a soul on this earth who can get you out of it. What does that mean? You can't get it out of my grip.
Man.
Have you ever had your child try to get the quarter out your hand? They ain't strong enough. They can't get you holding that quarter like this. And they just trying to pry everything. God sitting there like this to the devil. You can't. Please. Boy, please. Please. And whatever the devil gets, God opens it and says, here. You can have that.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But whatever you take, I will restore it.
Amen.
Next verse. Last one. I'm only giving you two, because I don't think you can handle any more. Psalm 139:10 says, even there, well, even where, you pick where there is. Even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall.
Oh.
Ooh. Have you ever been somewhere there that you think God is not there? Oh, snap. Oh, yes, I have. I've been there. Have you been there? Do you know where there is? Even there. Somebody say, even there.
Even there.
Even there. Even there. Even there.
Yes.
Your hand will lead me. Mm-hmm. And your hand shall.
Amen. Amen.
That's all I can give you.
So good.
The conclusion is, we need to go from a grip like this to open hands like this.
Thank you.
Ours is a death grip holding on to him. His is a life grip holding on to us.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
Hold on to me, Jesus.
Yes.
Because I'm losing my grip.
Amen.
If you live long enough, you're going to start losing your grip.
I know, that's right.
And the stuff you used to feel like it was so necessary to argue about,
mm-hmm.
10 years ago, you start, you can have it.
Right.
All right.
Yes.
Sure. Whatever you say. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Got it. Great. Next. Come on, Ariana Grande. Help me. Thank you. Next. Come on. Thank you. Next. Right?
Amen.
I've learned to let go of what is killing me.
So true.
And I've learned to put my hands in what is giving me life.
Amen.
I turn it over to Jesus. And he makes it right. So if you ever feel you're losing your grip on God, Lori, Lolo, don't try harder to hold on. Let go. And let God hold on to you.
Amen.
Like it's just getting harder and harder to just keep this thing afloat. Ooh, Riri. Just let it go. And let God hold on to you.
Amen.
Woo, you can't hold on to it. Because when he holds us in, we're safe. We're safe in the arms of the Almighty God.
Yes.
Baby sister, I think you're going to like this one. Jeremiah 29:11.
Yes.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. You don't need to grip this. He's got that. And you don't need to grip this. He's forgiven that. What you need to do is come stand in the middle and say, God, hold on to me while I do my best to serve you for
me.
God is gently reminding his children who are feeling in despair, feeling forsaken, and feeling forgotten that they are forever in the impressions of his hand.
Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
For that truth. That's real talk.
Amen.
I'm PC. And that's all I got. I hope today's message encouraged you in some way, and I hope that you were blessed. Type your comments in online. I'd love to see them. I'd love to hear them. I read all the comments after service each week just to see if you're tracking. Thank you so much for being a part of service today. It's been my pleasure to share the Word of God with you today. Thank you, Pastor Cherry, for preaching to us. For preaching to us today. Join us next week for another amazing service. I'm looking forward to spending time with you once again. Again, asking you guys to be safe during the holidays. Pray for the ministry. Go to the prayer wall. Let's keep each other in prayer. We just want God to answer the prayers and give us victory in the areas of our life. I think that's it. Joy, not anything else? Nothing? I'm good. Everybody good? All right. I'll take a look at the comments later on. I hope you guys have a great week. Let me pray for you. Father, we thank you for today's service. We pray your blessings as we go from this place, that we take this word that becomes seed in our hearts, that it germinates, that it takes root, that it brings forth fruit, that it brings forth life in the long run. God, we pray that the enemy would not be able to steal what you have placed inside us today. We commit our lives to you. Take us from this place, but never from your presence. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, people. God bless you. Have a great and awesome week. I'll see you next week. Thank you for joining in with Sunday Worship with Pastor Cherry. God bless you. Love. This song is called Help Me to See Me the Way You See Me, Lord. Come on, let's worship him this morning. He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah.
Help me to see.
Oh yes. The way you see me.
The way you see me.
Sometimes I see pain,
sometimes
Lord.
I see pain, Lord.
When you see victory.
When you see victory.
I see where I am, Lord.
I see where I am, Lord.
But you see where I shall
you
be.
See where I shall
open my
be.
Eyes. Help me believe.
Open my eyes.
I am. What you see.
I am what you see.
Come on, let's try it one more time. Hallelujah. Help me to see
me. Help
me
to see me.
The way
you see me.
Oh, sometimes I see pain, Lord. When you see my victory. You see where I shall be. Oh, open my eyes. Help me believe I am what you see. Come on, you see me victorious.
You see me faithful.
Oh, yes, you see me believing. Oh, that you are able.
Survive. Open my eyes. Help me believe I am what you see.
Come on, let's go back
help
to the top.
To see
yes.
Me the way you see me.
Sometimes I see pain, Lord, but you see victory.
See where I am, Lord. You see where I shall.